you. Thanks. Well, good morning, everyone. And I can tell you how personally excited I am to be the one to deliver Macworld 2009's keynote to you. And I can't tell you how much I appreciate you all showing up and bringing your energy and enthusiasm to this keynote. So from the bottom of my heart, thank you so much. It is an incredibly exciting time at Apple. There is so much going on across all of our businesses, all around the world. And you can feel it in so many ways, but probably nowhere better than in all these incredible stores that Ron and his team has opened around the world. Here's our store last year. We opened in Beijing, China. An incredibly beautiful place. Here's Munich, Germany. We opened it to crowds and crowds of people in Europe. And this one, and this photo is just unbelievable. This is Sydney, Australia. A beautiful city, has a beautiful Apple store. But just look at the crowds of people lining up in that store. And I don't know about you, but when I look at this photo, and I look at that big, gorgeous, glowing Apple up in front of it, and I think, what other company's logo could be there could ever imagine in that photo? And I can't think of one company in the world that could have a store that beautiful, such incredible customers coming, bringing all their energy and love to visit with our stores and talk to the sales consultant and get help with the geniuses and do one-on-one training. I couldn't imagine any other company delivering something like that. Each and every week, now 3.4 million customers visit an Apple store around the world. That's unbelievable, unbelievable. And I'm sorry, I have to make the comparison. That's 100 Macworlds each and every week going on around the world in our Apple stores. So it's no wonder that what's happening with these stores is just so important to us. And they do it because they're such a great place to shop, but they also come because they want to get their hands on and touch and try out an iPhone, an iPod Touch, and yes, the Mac. The Mac has had a resurgence and excitement and interest with customers bigger than we've ever had before. And I tell you, that means so much to us because it is an important part of our business. So today, what I'm going to talk to you about is all about the Mac. I think that's appropriate at Macworld that we talk about the Mac. Last fiscal year, we had the biggest year in the history of the company in Mac sales. We sold 9.7 million Macs. We're so proud of that. Everyone worked so hard, and we did it by growing over twice as fast as the rest of the industry. And that's because we have the best product line we've ever had for the Mac. Up and down the line, amazing, great, beautiful products. The hardware, the Leopard, Mac OS X operating system, all the amazing applications, it's just tremendous. Well, if you want to hear some new things today, and I assume some people want to hear a few new things today, well, I've got three new things to tell you about. And I'm really excited to be the one to tell you about each one of these things, because they're really special. First, number one, an entire new version of iLife, iLife 09. Now, hopefully, a lot of you know that iLife has become one of the reasons people buy a Mac today, because we all use these incredible applications. They're so helpful, they're so useful and fun. iPhoto, iMovie, GarageBand, iWeb, iDVD, there's nothing like it on any other computer platform. And as much as some people up north might think that they have some things that are pretty good, there's nothing as good as iLife on a personal computer. So what's new in iLife 09? First up, a brand new version of iPhoto, iPhoto 09. Last year, we introduced an idea to a technology in iPhoto called Events. So not only could you see the thousands of photos in iPhoto, you could look at them by events. And that took thousands of photos and made it down to a manageable couple hundred events, because they're based on time, a birthday party you attend, a vacation you go on. And it's turned out to be incredibly useful Customers use it, love it. It's just a natural, intuitive way to use all your photos. Well, this year with iPhoto 09, we're adding two events, another way for you to manage your photos called Faces. It's really powerful. So many of the photos we take are of people we care about, our family, our friends, coworkers. Wouldn't it be great if iPhoto allowed you to organize your photos down around all your favorite people, so it's really easy to get and find whatever you want? Well, that's what's in iPhoto 09. We've added a new feature in your library called Faces. And it's really beautiful. When you click on Faces, you get this great new user interface. It's a corkboard with snapshots of all your favorite people. If you want to find their photos, you just go into their snapshot and there they are. It's really cool. How does it work? Well, Faces uses a technology called face detection. Yes. So when you go into an event, for example, this is a camping event, and I click on a picture, there's a new button on the bottom that says, name this person. Because iPhoto wants you to tell it who these people are. And face detection finds the face in the photo so that you can then click on it and type in the name. We'll say, this is Liz. And that's it. That's all you have to do to tell iPhoto whose face you want to track in the Faces feature. So when you go back to Faces now Liz has a snapshot in your Faces area of iPhoto. iPhoto has another technology called face recognition to not only find the faces in your photo, but find the same person across multiple photos. So how does that work? Well, you go into Liz's snapshot, and what you see up above is the picture where you confirmed, yes, that's Liz in that picture. Down below, iPhoto has looked through your photo library and found some other photos that it thinks might be Liz and is asking you just to confirm that so it knows how to find Liz across all your different photos. That's face recognition. And all you have to do is just single click on some of them and say, yeah, those are Liz. Or if you want, double click on a photo that isn't Liz to say that's not. And that extra help really helps iPhoto out a lot to do a great job finding all your photos of the person you're tracking. Now, there's no perfect face detection and face recognition in anyone's software, but this is the best technology we've found. We think it works really well, and it's incredibly easy to use. So that's Faces. I think you're going to love using it in iPhoto. Well, in addition to events and Faces, we're adding a third way to help you find all your favorite photos. It's called Places. So now we're adding Faces and Places. A lot of the photos, in fact, all of them are of places, right? They're places we visit, places we go on vacations and trips. And it wouldn't be great if iPhoto can organize your photos around where they were taken. And that's just we've added, also in the library, under events, under Faces, we've added Places. And when you click on Places, what do you see? You see a map. And that map has pins where all your photos were taken. I mean, it couldn't be any easier than that. So how does Places work? Places uses a technology called GPS geotagging. Well, GPS chips we're finding in more and more things. In fact, they're starting to make their way into cameras. So new cameras like this Nikon Coolpix and the most advanced cell phone on the market, hopefully many of you have one, it's the iPhone, it also has a GPS chip in it. And both of these devices embed a geotag right into the photos you take. Well, what's a geotag? It's really simple. It's a big word for longitude and latitude. So for example, when you take a photo, the geotag is automatically assigned by that camera or by the iPhone to the photo you took. Now, it's not that useful to know that I took this photo at 48 degrees, 51 minutes, 33.14 seconds north. So the other thing iPhoto does, it reverse encodes that geotag, and it figures out, well, that's actually at the Eiffel Tower. In fact, it figures out more about it. It's the Eiffel Tower, and that's the city in Paris, and that's in the country of France. And you have access to all that information to use to search your photos or organize them any way you'd like. Now, I know you're probably wondering, well, what about all those photos I took that I didn't have a GPS chip in a camera and it doesn't have a geotag in it? Well, that's easy too. So for example, let's go into this backpacking event. Maybe it's something we did back in 2007. We didn't have a GPS chip in our camera. Well, now when you click on the event, there's a little information button. You flip over the event, and there's a new field up there that says enter event location. And you just type in where you went on that event. In this case, Yosemite. Well, iPhoto has a database of thousands of locations. It recognizes what you're typing in and figures out that's Yosemite, a great national park in California. It puts a pin on the map right where that is, and it assigns a geotag to all the photos in that event. That simply. So it's really easy for you to add a location to your entire database of photos if you want them all to be placed on the map for you. So where do these maps come from? We actually are getting the maps from the Google Maps service. And so if you've ever used Google Maps on the web, you know exactly how to use this map. You double-click on it to zoom in. You can go right down to street level and see to the individual street where you were taking those photos. And at any time on the map, when you see a pin, you can just click on it, and it'll take you to where you've seen your photos. Oh, in addition to street maps, we also have satellite imagery as well. So you can see satellite images. Again, click on a pin, and you go right to the photos taken at that location. And because this is places, it has all the photos you've taken, even if they're across different events, because it's about a place now. So that's places. So places joins faces. It's a brand new feature in iPhoto. Now those two things would be enough right there. Those are great, powerful new features. In addition, we've added a lot more depth and power to iPhoto. I want to mention a few other things. We have support for some online services. If you use Facebook or Flickr, that's built right in. So how does that work? Well, for example, maybe you have a picture or a few of your friends. And of course, you've used faces in iPhoto, so there's some faces of the people you know have been assigned to them. And if you have your Facebook account set up, you just click the new Facebook button right there at the bottom of iPhoto, and it sends the photo right up to Facebook for you to share with your friends. One of the cool things is Facebook allows other people to name people in the photos if they know who they are, even if you don't. So let's say the person on the far right, you didn't know who that was. One of your friends can, in Facebook, assign that name, and it gets synced right back down to your iPhoto, and you get that name too. So that's Facebook. We also have support for Flickr. Flickr is a great service where thousands and thousands of beautiful photos are shared, and you can do the same thing. So maybe you've had this photo of this scenery that you want to share up on with the world up on Flickr. There's a button built right into iPhoto. You click it and share your photo up onto Flickr, and now it's there with your Flickr account for everyone to look at. But what's really cool is Flickr also supports geotagging. So it reads the data that we send up from iPhoto, and people can see the places where you took your photos all automatically, built in with geotags. So that's Facebook and Flickr support. Now, once you have all your photos in there, it's really easy with events or places or faces to do a lot of really fun things. One of the simple fun things to do is to show them to other people via a slideshow. So we have a great new feature called slideshow themes. So when you go to pick an event, let's say, for example, this ballet practice on the bottom left-hand side, you want to took some photos at your child's ballet practice, and you want to go in and show that class, you just click it and press the slideshow button, and a new panel shows up. We can not only assign music to your slideshow and set timing, but you can pick one of the built-in themes, and they're really beautiful. So let me show you this ballet theme right now. And one of the cool things about that theme is you notice how beautifully the faces were in the center of the photos? They weren't taken that way. We actually use the face detection to properly position the photos in the middle of your slideshow that you play back for people. Maybe your kids are a little older. Here's another theme. Give you an example of the shattered theme. Cool. That's a great 3D theme. Now, one of the great things about making a slideshow in iPhoto 09 is you can also save the slideshows directly to your iTunes copy so that you can now sync them onto your iPod Touch, your iPhone, and get the exact same slideshow to show your family and friends right here on your iPhone. So that's some of the features, thank you, in the new iPhoto. When in addition to showing slideshows, one of the things that's been really popular with our customers is to print out photos and books right from their events and now places and faces they create. And they're beautiful books, and we've updated them with even more themes and even more beautiful printing. And I want to give you one example. This is the new updated travel book theme. Here's what it looks like. It's absolutely stunning. And inside, in the theme, we have maps. So we use the geotag data so you can automatically get maps in your books of the places you travel in the photo event that you're showing in this book. You can also have maps that have pins for the photos on that page and where they were taken. And that's all done automatically inside the new book feature on iPhoto 09. And you can print now not only on the sleeve, but customers have asked us to print on the hardcover as well. These are gorgeous new books. So that's the new books. So if you don't mind, I'd really love to be the first to show you the real brand new iPhoto 09 running here on my Mac. So here's iPhoto, it's real, not just a slide. And there's events, something we've had in this last year. It's really great. You can skim over all the events and find all your favorite photos. But now, we have this new feature, Faces. So you saw the snapshots, but the thing the slide didn't show you is how interactive and cool it is. So if I pass my mouse over anyone's snapshot, I see all the faces within that snapshot. And you see how iPhoto with face detection zooms right in on the face. If I hold down the Option key, I see the entire photo. I can look at the whole photo. Just the faces of the person in the photo. So it's really easy to manage all your friends and faces, but how do you create them? So let's go back to events. I'm gonna pick event, this event called City of Light. I'm gonna go into it. Let me pick a photo. I'll pick this first one at the top. And let's say that's a person I haven't been tracking yet with faces. So I'm gonna go into their photo, and I'm gonna click this new button, Name. When I do, immediately face detection finds the face in that photo, and it doesn't know who this is, so it says unknown name. So I'm gonna type that person's name. That's Allie. And that's it. I've named Allie, and now Allie will be in my faces section. I can manage it. Before I go back there, I'm gonna hit the right arrow, go to the next photo in this event, and you see what iPhoto's done? On this photo, it says first, on the right, it's asking me, is this Allie? So face recognition at work, it already recognized that might be Allie, and it just wants me to confirm it with a check to be certain, yes, that definitely is Allie. And the person on the left doesn't know who that is. Well, that's Allie's mother, so I'm gonna name her Claire. And that's it. Now let me go to faces, and you see Allie and Claire have been added with snapshots because they're people I'm tracking in faces. Let's go inside Allie's face here, and now you see I've select two photos I confirmed were Allie, so they're above the line. Those are for certain Allie. Down below, instantly, this is thousands of photos in this library, it's found all these other photos that it believes is Allie. I could just use these now, create slideshows or books, but I want to help iPhoto out a little more, give it more information. So I'm going to click this button down below that says confirm name. And what you see, it zoomed right in with face detection on Allie's face in all these photos. Yeah. I want to confirm that these are definitely Allie and help iPhoto. I just click on them once, and those are definitely Allie. I can even do it faster. I'm just going to drag over all these photos, and automatically they've all been confirmed, and click done. And now I've added more photos up above that are automatically recognized as Allie. And with that little bit of help, iPhoto can do an even better job finding more photos that are absolutely Allie, and that's all I have to do. So I've made it really easy for iPhoto. Let me go back to faces. One other cool thing you can do is I skim across all these photos of Allie, I can just pick one and say, well, that's the one I want to be on the snapshot, so I hit the space bar, and that now gets saved as the default view of Allie in all the photos. One more really fun thing. Imagine that's your family on the bottom, a mother and father and two kids, and you want to keep track of all their photos at once. I'm just going to drag across all four, and then I'm going to drag them onto the left-hand sidebar here and let go, and it's automatically made a smart album with all four people in it. I can name that. So name that our family. And now, whenever I go into that smart album, every photo that I've confirmed is one of those four people is always in that album, and I don't have to go hunting for them. So that's Faces. Faces is really powerful. Now let me show you Places. Places is just as cool. So I'm going to click on Places, and there, over the internet, we've got our map, and iPhoto has placed pins on the map of the places we've taken photos. The more you zoom in, the more detail you'll get. So here's the United States. And I can, for example, hover over this pin. Some photos were taken in Aspen. So whenever I see a pin and a name, I can just click the right arrow and go right to all those photos. So those are the photos that were taken at Aspen, even if they're across multiple events. So it's really easy to find your photos and look at them. Let's go back to events. Well, as I said, you might have photos that you took a while ago that weren't assigned GPS tags. For example, this pumpkin patch event was taken in 2007 and didn't have a GPS camera being used. So I'm going to click the information button, flip it open, and it says enter event location. So I'm going to start typing this really cool city out here on the coast, Half Moon Bay. See, I don't have to type very far. It recognizes the name from its list of places. I hit return. It's put a pin on the map on Highway 92 on the way to Half Moon Bay, and it's all assigned. Every photo in that event is now assigned to that location in Half Moon Bay, and I'm done. It's really that easy to add locations to all my events. Let me go to a second event. This one was taken with a camera with a GPS chip inside it, the City of Light event. Let me flip it open. This is really cool. There are the pins of the location of every photo taken in this event automatically on that map. Isn't that nice? If I skim over the photos, the pins highlight blue on whichever one I'm looking at. Very cool. And in the bottom of the map, there's a little arrow. It says show in places. I can go right from this window to places. So I'm going to do that. Let me click show in places. It takes me right to places, zoomed in on the map, right around all those photos where they were taken in Paris. So that's really cool. And I can zoom in, double click on a map. As I said, we also have a satellite view. Let's bring up the satellite view. Going even further. You can see the Eiffel Tower right there. I see a pin on it. Someone also pointed out, wait a minute, there's a pin on the water. Well, of course, they took a boat ride along the Seine and took a picture of it. But let me click on this pin right here of the Eiffel Tower, and sure enough, there are the photos that were taken at the Eiffel Tower, right there in places. Well, let's go back to the map. I also know some photos were taken of the around the Arc de Triomphe, but I don't remember exactly where that was on the map. Well, I could scroll around until I find it, but there's another view in places I haven't shown you yet. This is the map view. On the bottom, I also have a column view. The column view across the top lists all the places that I've taken photos in the world. It's got countries, cities, states, famous events, famous locations, and I can click on any one of them to get those photos. I can click on the United States. There's all my photos taken in the United States. I can click on California, all the photos taken in California. I'm going to see over on the far right, well, there it is, Arc de Triomphe. I select it, and there are the photos taken at the Arc de Triomphe. I don't have to find it on the map. When I click back on the map, there they are. There are the photos around the Arc de Triomphe. So that is an example of using the brand new Places feature along with Faces in iPhoto 09. Well, I hope you're as excited about it as I am. Love taking photos, love managing them in iPhoto. And iPhoto 09 with all these amazing features, and that's just some of them, didn't get to touch on them all, is incredible. And that's just the first of all the new products in iLife 09. If that isn't exciting enough, well, we've got a brand new version of iMovie as well. Yeah. Ooh. iMovie was entirely new last year. Last year, we had this amazing thing happen. One of our engineers, a brilliant engineer, came to us and said he had a whole new idea of a way to do video editing that would be faster and easier and more fun. And it was so amazing, we decided to completely rewrite iMovie. and come out with a whole new version. Really, the only thing that was the same was the name. And in doing that, it was the first version last year. And iMovie has been around for quite a while and had a lot of depth of features. And not every feature was there for every customer. And some people said, look, this is really cool, but I missed some of the features I had previously. It's not everything I need yet. Well, this year, in this new version of iMovie 09, we've added so much depth and so much power that we really think it's going to be the video editing product that every customer is blown away with and loves. So what's in the new iMovie 09? Well, first, a very powerful way to do editing with a new precision editor. Advanced users can bring up an expanded view of their timeline and see their edits up close, edit the audio, edit the video, edit the transition with amazing control. Now, so much power, but it's still incredibly easy to use. When you drag videos into the timeline, we have a new advanced drag and drop feature. So you drag one video on top of another, context-sensitive menus pop up, showing you all the powerful things you can do with a single click. When you started to lay out all your clips, you can instantly make a beautiful movie with new dynamic themes, where you just, with a single click, select a theme, and iMovie automatically creates titles, transitions, effects, even credits, all for you with a single click. And it has this really cool feature. This is my favorite thing. It's called animated travel maps. A lot of the videos you take are of places you visit. Well, now you can automatically create 2D and 3D maps showing where you traveled right in your video. And if you're not the world's best videographer, maybe some of your videos get a little jittery. Well, we've got automatic video stabilization, where iMovie will stabilize your video and take away all those jitters. And so things that might not have been usable before are now beautiful, pristine videos to include in your movie. Now, I'm blowing through these really fast, all these features, for a reason. Because it's video editing, and it's really hard to talk about on a slide. So the right way to show you the product is with a demo of the brand new iMovie 09. And I've done something really special. I've asked the engineer who came up with this brilliant idea for this new way to do video editing to do the demo for us. So please give a warm welcome to Randy Ubilos, the Chief Architect of Video Applications at Apple. Randy.
Thanks, Phil. Nice. Good morning. Very excited to be out here and get to show you all the cool new features in iMovie 09. So let's jump right in. I'm going to start out showing you some editing. So just like iMovie 08, we've got the great skimming that allows me to look through my content. I'm just going to go ahead and select a bit of this and just drag it up to my project. That'll add that in. We've got another shot here, and it'd be really nice to insert this in the middle of this clip. All I have to do with iMovie 09 is let go, and up pops this new menu. And because I have the advanced mode turned on in preferences, I get even more choices than what Phil showed before. I get things like cutaway, picture-in-picture, green screen that are available to me. But we're going to go ahead and do an insert. And so once I do the insert there, the clip gets dropped in right at the spot where I let go. I can play that back. And you see we have a nice cut over to that shot. Let's take a look at a clip down here.
I'm sure you're going to miss this place. Never going to forget it.
That's a great dialogue shot, and the sound there would be really nice to put in underneath the video that we were just looking at. So I'm just going to skim along here and just select it.
I'm sure you're going to miss this place. Never forget it.
Skimming makes it really easy to find exactly that piece of audio. I'll take this up and I'll drop it up here. And this time what I'm going to choose is audio only. And what that's going to do is just place the audio in underneath the video. And let's go ahead and play that back. So really easy to do that kind of mixture of audio and video. Let's go ahead and I've got a clip down here, one of the kids jumping in the lake. Kind of fun. Let's go ahead and select a piece of that. And we'll drag that up into the project. And we have another shot here that was taken a little while later where he kind of jumps in again. So I'll go ahead and select that one. And I'm going to drag that up in here. And let's take a look at that. So those are some nice clips, but we could make that look a lot better if we tightened up the action. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to use the new action pop-up, and I'm going to choose the precision editor. When I do that, what drops down is a magnified view of the edit that we're working on. And what you see here is everything on the upper line is all of the material to the left of the edit, and everything on the lower line is everything to the right of the edit. And I can skim back and forth and actually see the edit happen, but I can also skim on this clip and I can see the content before and after the edit on the clip on the left, and I can do the same thing on the clip on the right. So I can see all the different material that could be used for this edit. And everything you see here is interactive. I can grab this clip and move it back and forth. I can grab this clip and move it back and forth and adjust the edit any way that I'd like. Another really cool thing that I can do is I can actually come in here and just pick a spot and just click. And when I click, that point will slide over and that becomes the point where the edit takes place in that clip. Let's come down to this clip here and I'll pick a corresponding spot here where he goes in the water and we'll click. And now let's take a look at the edit. So we've got this nice kind of shift in the angle. Now, very, very easy. So if we just take a listen here now to the audio, notice the audio shifts there because the audio is cutting at the same point the video does, and so because of the change in the angle, it sounds different. We can take care of that by just selecting the audio button here, and now I can actually see my audio track separately here, and I can actually go in and I can adjust this separately by dragging it. So now what I've done is I've made the audio on the first clip extend beyond the edit point. So let's go ahead and play that back. So we just get a nice clean piece of audio from the clip on the left. So as you can see, this is a really complex edit. In a pro tool, this would take a lot more steps, and we've done it in a nice, really interactive visual way. Next thing I want to show, I want to switch to a different project. So the way I'll do that is I'll click and go to my new project library. The project library now shows you these great little film strips of each of your projects, so it makes it really easy to find. I'm going to switch over to this project of an African safari. This is actually some footage that I shot about a year ago on a trip to Africa, and I'll switch over to the corresponding event. Let's go ahead and take a look at this clip down here. This was shot in the back of a Jeep that was bouncing along, and the footage probably wouldn't be something that you'd actually use because there's just too much motion in it. One of the really cool new features we have is video stabilization. Now this stabilization is done in a two-step process. The first step, the iMovie goes through and analyzes each frame of your video and compares it to the one before and one after and figures out what all the motion is. That takes some time, but it can be done on an entire event all at once. And once that's been done, as it has for this event here, all I have to do is select the segment of the video that I want and just drag it up here into my project. And when we play it back now, the stabilization's been applied and it almost looks like the car was floating along there. So you can see a huge difference. Now, I have another clip down here, and this one we were kind of chasing some gazelle in a Jeep, and it's almost hard to see the gazelle in there because the Jeep is bouncing around so much. If I just go ahead and take that clip, select it, and then drag it up here into my timeline, and now when I play it back, now the gazelle pop out because it's been stabilized so much. And you notice, all I had to do was just drag that in and the stabilization takes place. Let's take a look at another clip down here. We've got this great shot of this leopard coming down out of the tree, but it goes by so fast. It'd be really cool if we could slow that down. So let's go ahead, we'll select this, and I'm just gonna drag this up here into my project. And now from the action menu, I'm gonna choose clip adjustments. This brings up my inspector and allows me to adjust things. So we've got a nice slider here for speed. If I drag it to the right, the clip will go faster. Drag it to the left, the clip will go slower. We'll go ahead and do that, and let's just play that back. You'll notice it's now at half speed, no rendering, no waiting, takes place immediately. Another cool feature we have here is we have video effects. So we've got some great effects that you can do, and all I have to do is skim back and forth across the thumbnail, and I can see what it looks like. We've got some really cool effects like cartoon, we've got a nice vignette, we've even got an X-ray effect. One that a lot of people like is aged film. So I'm going to go ahead and select that. And so now if I play this back, this clip's been stabilized, slowed down, and the aged film has been added. No rendering, all done in real time. It's going to make it really easy to enhance your movies. So we've added a number of other elements for enhancing your movies. Over here on my Maps and Backgrounds panel, you can see we have four different styles of map, and we have flat and globe maps. I'm gonna go ahead and grab a flat education map, drag it up into my project, and now all I have to do is set the starting and ending location. We actually did start in San Francisco, which is the default, but the trip was actually to Botswana. So I'm just gonna type in a couple of letters. The list is filtered down. I select Botswana, and I can actually change what I want the name on the map to be. So I'll just type in Safari, and then when we go ahead and play this back, you get this really cool animated map from one location to another. I can even just take one of the other styles and drag it on top of this one. When I let go, it remembers the starting and ending location. Let's take a look at this one. We get this really cool animated map, and you can even stack these together if you went from through multiple cities along the way. So some really cool maps that we have now. We have some other elements. We have some new transitions. We have a whole bunch of new animated titles that are really cool. The thing I'm going to show you now is our themes. So with the themes, we have five themes, and I can skim across to get a look at what they, how they look. We have things like comic book and scrapbook, film strip. I'm going to go ahead and pick photo album. And when I select this, what iMovie is going to do is it's going to go in and it's going to add some titles and transitions. It's going to go ahead and put a title at the beginning, and it's going to use the name of our project automatically. It's going to put in some cool transitions in here. It's going to mix those with cross dissolves. And it's even, down at the end, going to put an ending slide in, and it's going to use the name from the address book on this machine. This is Phil's machine, so it's picked up his name automatically. So let's go ahead and switch over to full screen and take a look at what that looks like. So you can see how nice and professional those look. So super easy to create really great looking movies. This is actually just a subset of all the new features in iMovie 09. I encourage you to go down to the booth or go to apple.com to check out the full set of features. Thanks very much.
Isn't that incredible? An amazing software, and thanks to Randy and his team and to everyone who's worked on it. It's so powerful. And just watching that, I'm so impressed that I edited that myself. So that's just some of the features in that new iMovie 09 that's going to make it a video editing product that every customer is going to love. Old iMovie users as well as all the new people that are going to get into video editing now with this incredible software. So that's the second application in the new iLife 09. I'd like to show you just one more. I'd like to talk to you about the new GarageBand 09. Now, GarageBand 09 has a number of really great features, great new guitar effects, great way to jam in Magic GarageBand, but I'm not going to tell you about those. I want to tell you about just one feature because it's really the most exciting one and a true breakthrough. The team was challenged with doing something no one's ever done before, to create a piece of software that can help people learn to play a musical instrument. So that's the biggest new feature in GarageBand 09. It's called Learn to Play. So what's Learn to Play? Well, when you go into Learn to Play, you get a new user interface. You can learn to play a guitar or keyboards. You see the instrument you've chosen facing you, so you can easily see what you're going to learn on that instrument. You have an instructor up above. In this case, this is Tim, and it's in HD resolution, and he's going to teach you how to play the instrument. And down below at the bottom of the window are controls so that you control the rate at which you learn, the sections you're studying, do it slowly, quickly, jump ahead. You're in complete control of the learning experience. So let me just play a snippet of one of these lessons to give you a feel for what it's like to learn to play in GarageBand 09.
This is the first in a series of lessons that will help you learn how to play the guitar. In this one, I'll give you a short introduction to the instrument and help you get started quickly with some music that's really easy to play. Many blues and jazz songs use a chord progression called the 12-bar blues. We're going to learn the progression in the key of A using the three chords A, D, and E.
So that little snippet gives you a taste of what it's like for Tim to teach you how to play the guitar. You saw the guitar playing, you saw where your fingers go, and then the controls going along the bottom. You can repeat that if you need a little more time to learn it just right. Here's a snippet of what it's like to learn something on a keyboard.
In this lesson, you'll learn how to read some music and how it relates to the notes that we already know on the piano keyboard. Let's add the bass part to the new chord progression. Put your left thumb on middle C.
So in addition to what you saw in the last lesson, this one now you see what it's like to have notation turned on to learn the notation along with how to play the keyboard. It's so simple and such a breakthrough way to learn music. But with the new GarageBand 09, we bundle for free 9 basic lessons for guitar, 9 basic lessons for piano, and you download the ones that you want to use when you need to use them. But the really cool part is once you've started to learn the instrument, when you actually want to learn to play a song. And to do that, we've enlisted the help of some amazing artists to teach you to play their songs. We call this feature Artist Lessons. So, hold your applause, because this is really cool. So who are some of the artists that are going to teach you to play the guitar and keyboard? Well, first, some of the guitar players.
Hi, I'm John Fogarty. And for you guys that are just starting out on guitar, I'm going to show you a simple way to play my song, Proud Mary.
Hi, I'm Colby, and I'm here to teach you how to play a simple version of my song, Bubbly.
Hi, I'm Patrick, and I'm going to show you how to play my band Fall Out Boy's song, I Don't Care.
Hi, I'm Sting, and I'm here to teach you my song, Roxanne.
So that's a few of the guitar players, and there's more, right? Yeah. What about the keyboard?
Hi, I'm Sarah. I'm going to be teaching you today how to play a simplified version of my song, Angel.
Hi, I'm Ryan, lead singer of One Republic, and right now I'm going to show you how to play the first single off our debut album, Dreaming Out Loud. This is Apologize.
Hi, I'm Nora, and I'm here to teach you one of my songs. This is called Thinking About You.
So, incredible artists, and we're going to continue to add more and more along the way. And this is so amazing that they are going to teach you their songs. So when you go in the new GarageBand 09, there's now a new section called Learn to Play. And that's the place where you keep all your lessons. So you can go back as many times as you want and decide what you want to work on, some basic lessons, some of the artist lessons that you've downloaded. There's a built-in store in the GarageBand. That's where you can download those bundled basic lessons. And you purchase the artist lessons. They're $4.99 a lesson. And they're incredibly rich. Inside these lessons, the artists talk to you about their song. They tell you some of the story behind it. You can see the lyrics. As you saw, you see notation. You can practice with their original recorded tracks that they made for you to learn with. You can also move it into GarageBand and create your own mix based on the lessons that you've purchased. And you can slow down at your own pace and do it over and over again and learn these songs really well till you nail it. You can get out there and play Fall Out Boy song or Fogarty song. It's so, so much fun. But to give you a little bit more sense of it, I want to show you some more clip of one of the lessons so you can start to feel how cool these really are.
Well, it was early 1968, the best I can remember it. We had just finished, or were just finishing up recording the first album, which was called Creedence Clearwater Revival. I became aware or fascinated with the opening notes of Beethoven's Fifth. You know, bum, 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 bum. That's the right way. But I couldn't play that with chords on the guitar. So kind of bouncing off Beethoven's inspiration, I knew it needed something else to turn into a guitar riff. Well, now we come to the verse of Proud Mary. It's based around the D chord. And I've always thought D is just a really bright and uplifting sound, beautiful sound. Sounds sunny, sounds happy. And you can tell already that's starting to sound like that rolling, rolling, chugging rhythm that Proud Mary is known for. Thank you. B minor chord, and back to that D chord.
So that's just a clip of all this incredible content in these GarageBand lessons. Now you see why that's the one feature to talk about. It is so unbelievable and so much fun. So that's GarageBand 09. So those are the three applications in the whole new iLife 09 suite I wanted to talk to you about. There's also, of course, a new version of iWeb and iDVD as well. So that's iLife 09. As you know, iLife ships free on all new Macs, one of the many reasons the Mac is the best personal computer in the world. And to upgrade, as before, $79. And if you have more than one computer in your household, you can upgrade a family pack for $99. That's up to five computers in a house. And the new iLife 09 will ship at the end of this month, late January. So that's iLife 09. And that's the first thing we wanted to talk to you about. So number two, we also have a completely new version of iWork, iWork 09 as well. And as you know, iWork is made up of Keynote, Pages, and Numbers. So first up, Keynote 09. It's some, what I'm working on and using this presentation, so you know it's rock solid. Keynote 09. Well, one of the things we focused on in Keynote 09 is giving you some really powerful animation tools that combined all together can help you make incredible professional presentations, but really easily. So what are those tools? First up, something we call Magic Move. Magic Move is a transition between slides where you set up your slides and I in Keynote does all the work to move your objects between the slides. So for example, let's say this is your first slide, you got a bunch of cards on it, and to make a second slide, you just move a bunch of the cards off and you take that Queen of Hearts and you make it bigger, you tilt it on an angle, you create a reflection, you set it up the way you want, and then you use Magic Move and Keynote will do the transition for you. So for example, it looks like this. Here's the first slide and now the second slide. So that animation's done by Keynote. Here's a second example. Slide one, cards are all messed up. Slide two, we organized them and asked Keynote to do a magic move between them. It's really simple, really powerful. So that's the magic move. Second, object transitions. What you can do with object transitions is have a lot of objects on your slide and ask Keynote to move from this set to another set of objects with a bunch of powerful transitions. So for example, the first object transition I'm going to show is called Object Zoom. We're going to zoom these objects from one slide to the next. And here's how it goes. Now if you look closely, those objects zoomed with a different rate of speed for the different objects. And the second slide started to show up on the first slide before it was even done and off the screen. Something near impossible for us to do with techniques ourselves, but automatic now in Keynote. Here's another one. That's really powerful, what I just explained with this perspective move. Check this out. So simple, beautiful, powerful transition. And now we're going to move these objects off the screen with an object push-up. Again, simple, powerful object transitions that you can combine with other techniques to make advanced presentations. And this last one, text transitions, are really great because the simplest thing, doing a transition between text objects, can be beautiful and really powerful. I really love the first example the team came up with. I like this one. It's called a swing transition. I like that one. Read whatever you want into it. Next, a shimmer, energy. It's for you, Al. And here, this is called an anagram. If you don't know what an anagram is, you will by watching this transition. There's an anagram transition. So great text transitions in addition to magic moves and object transitions. You put them all together with some really powerful tools to create your presentation in a way that people just won't believe how you did it. We also have animations on charts. The charting in Keynote is the best there's ever been in a presentation application. Beautiful charts with incredible textures on them. And these new chart animations bring in and bring out your charts in an incredible way. So first up, I'm going to do a crane move. Bring in this graph, and it's got a beautiful metallic shine that's reflecting as it's moved into the slide. Here comes another one, a rotate. Now we've got etched metal, and this is a new cylinder shape that's in Keynote 09 that you can use on your charts. Here's a third one, a rotate and grow with a chart using new stone texture on the chart. And the last one, a zoom through the Z-axis of a pie chart using the new beautiful wood textures as well. So we have incredible new chart animations to make your slides just beautiful. And in addition to all of this, of course, we have beautiful themes in Keynote. And now we have even more themes where you have these gorgeous setups like Kyoto. You just pick it, and all your slides have this beautiful look of the fonts and the graphics and the backgrounds. Here's Showroom, Brushed Canvas, Venetian. So that's just some of the new themes you can use to make your presentation beautiful in Keynote 09. There's one more feature. It's something you get extra, but it's really cool. If you want a way to wirelessly control your presentation, we have the new Keynote Remote. So what's this? This is an application you run on your iPhone or iPod Touch. You set it up to talk wirelessly using Wi-Fi to your Mac, whatever your Mac you're running the presentation on. And if you have it set up in a vertical mode, it shows you your slide plus any speaker notes you want. You set it up horizontally, and you see this slide and the next slide. And in either mode, you just flick it with your finger, and that's how you advance or move backwards and forwards through your slides. The Keynote Remote is an application. It'll be sold in our application store for 99 cents. And as you see, we've already given it 5-star reviews, so I know it's a big hit. So that's the Keynote Remote, and those are some of the new features in the new Keynote 09. Next up, Pages. So Pages 09, last year we did a lot of work on Pages to make it not only great for doing document designs, but also just a really great word processor. So we focused a lot more on that this year as well, making it even better for the things you want to write. Now, first up, a feature called Full Screen View. Well, sometimes you're working on the next great American novel and you're staring at that blank piece of paper and you just can't get time to get started because you're distracted with your email and your stocks updating on your web page or people instant messaging you, and you just want to stop and focus on your writing. So you click the new button up top for full screen view, and then you start writing, and you have the time to really focus on what you're doing because everything else disappears. And this is really powerful if you're using it with a design, because you really want to focus on the design, but again, you get a lot going on, you get a lot of applications running, so you just go into full screen view, and now you can really focus on what you're doing. Now, the menus are still active up above, so I can move my mouse up to the top, and there's the menu. For example, go into two up mode on the pages and stare at the whole design of my big, beautiful cinema display. And the page sorter on the left is still there, too. If I move my cursor to the left, it pops open, and I can pick what page I'm working on, get back to work. So that's the new full screen view in Pages to really help you work on your writing. Second, this has been asked for by a lot of customers, great outlining built right into Pages. So in Pages 09, you can start working on your document in an outline view if you want. Type your outline. There's control of different levels of your outline, different font sizes, graphics in line with your outline. Complete control of this. And like a good outliner, it's really powerful because you can reorganize your thoughts and your sections. And when you go back to your page view, it's all been organized according to your outline. They're completely connected and dynamic. So that's the new dynamic outline. Mail merge. There's some customers that do mail merge with Pages, and they do it previously by connecting to their address book. You can still do that, but now you can also connect to tables and lists you set up in Numbers, and the two work seamlessly together. Some of the products that our customers like to use a lot with Pages, we've made it work easily together with support built in for MathType and EndNote. MathType is used by a lot of engineers and scientists to create formulas that they want to use and math that they want to put into their documents, and now we've built an integration between Pages and MathType. And EndNote is used by scientists, engineers, people publishing papers where they want really complicated bibliographies, and that support's built in too. So those work seamlessly together now. And of course, one of the great things about Pages is beautiful templates, so that you can create gorgeous documents, but really simply. So we have even more templates now for newsletters, beautiful new poster templates. You can create really fun flyers. We've got certificates, really great things to use in education. And business correspondence with envelopes and letters and business cards you can create. So those are just some of the templates in the new pages, and that's Pages 09. And the third product in iWork 09, Numbers. Now last year, Numbers was the first time we brought it out, version 1.0, and customers really liked it because finally, it was a fun, easy-to-use spreadsheet done the Apple way. So this year, we focused on really filling out all those features customers tell us they wanted added to make it even more powerful in the spreadsheet they can choose to use all the time. And that's what we've done. So for example, in Numbers 09, we've added table categories. A lot of the data you add into a spreadsheet is actually a table. For example, this might be a list of kids trying out for the Little League in your town. You've got a long table you've entered with all their names and their position, and someone asks you, well, how many catchers and pitchers do we have? We need to figure out how many teams we can make. Oh, you need to reorganize your table. You didn't build it that way. Well, now you can pull down on a column, and there's a new categorized by this column choice. And you can reorganize your table by whatever column you want. So we'll categorize by the position column. We'll add a subtotal. And now you've automatically created a table based on that column, as opposed to how you had it organized by name before. And you can dynamically switch around any categorization you want. It's simple, but really powerful way to make your tables more useful. The most requested feature for advanced spreadsheet users was more powerful formulas with more functions. And we've added those in Numbers 09. There are over 250 functions now, but they're really easy to find and understand because we have this new function view. There's a list of all the functions you can type in and do a search for the function you're looking for. You get a nice description underneath so you can understand the function, what it does, and the variables it has. And when you paste it into your formula, it's done in a really easy to understand way. You see the function, you see the variables, you see descriptions of them. When you pass your mouse over them, you get a tooltip telling you what that variable does. When you start to hook up your spreadsheet to it and click on fields, it puts the name of that field into the variable so it's easy to see. And it's all color-coded so you see how it connects up. That's just a few of the ways that we've made formulas and functions more powerful and easy to use. There's some advanced chart options. Had a lot of interest in more features in charting. So we have mixed chart types. We have charts with multiple axes. We have trend lines and error bars. So these things have been really important to people doing financial charts or doing scientific charts. It gives them the tools they need to do some really advanced reporting on their spreadsheets. And a lot of our customers use Numbers with Keynote and Pages, so we've made it so they can link together and you can keep your charts updated. So let's say we have this running club chart we've created inside Numbers, and we cut and paste that, or copy and paste that into a Pages document. And now there's a new linked UI, so you can keep those linked. And anytime you update the Numbers spreadsheet, just by clicking that one button, it's kept up to date in your Pages document. You don't have to go and cut and paste it back together. They're now linked. And unusual for a spreadsheet, beautiful templates. So templates for doing home finance, templates for use in education, templates for keeping track of things at home, like home inventory. So lots of beautiful new templates. So that's Numbers 09. And that completes iWork 09. As before, iWork is $79, $99 if you want to get a family pack for at home. And for the first time with iWork, if you purchase iWork when you purchase a new Mac, you can get a really great deal of just $49. So for me, it becomes a no-brainer to get iWork when you get a new Mac. And iWork 09 starts shipping today. So that's iLife and iWork. We think a lot of customers are going to want to get both. And there's still some people out there who haven't upgraded to macOS 10 Leopard. Don't know why, but they really need to. It's time. And it's actually needed for the new iLife. And so some customers will look at it and say, well, I've got to go purchase all three. I'm not sure I want to do that yet. Well, we've made that really an easy choice for them because there's a new product called a Mac Box Set, where they can just get all the software in one box at a really nice deal for $169. So the Mac Box Set will ship in late January when iLife is also finished in shipping. So they'll ship as part of that. So that's iWork. Now there's one other thing we're doing with iWork that I'm really excited to tell you about. And it's a service we've been working on, a service called iWork.com. Now, this is a really, really cool idea. And we're going to be announcing the beta of this so customers can get involved with us and try it out and help us make it really great. So what is iWork.com? iWork.com is a new service for you to share your iWork documents with other people. You can easily upload your documents into iWork.com and notify other people that you've invited them to collaborate on the documents you're working on. And those people that you've shared it with can view the documents online. Simply go into the browser and see the documents and review them. They can add comments to the documents, they can add notes, and you see all those back as you look at them online as well. And probably one of the most powerful features is you can download a copy, and they can download a copy in multiple formats automatically via iWork.com. So you don't have to just copy and paste your documents into emails and send them to different people, and sometimes they can be large files and hard to get through email systems. They just go to iWork.com where you've shared the document and download it themselves whenever they need it. Now, this is a really exciting new service, so I'm proud to be the first to show you how it works and what it looks like. So first, I'm at my Mac, and I'm going to launch a document in the brand new Pages 09. So this is a document you can imagine in my spare time. I'm a rocket scientist, and I've been studying exploration in space. And I can look through my document, and yeah, I think it's really good now. I'd like to get some other people giving me some feedback on it, so I want to share it with some others. To do that, I'm going to use iWork.com. And there's a button now on the top of the new iWork applications, Pages, Numbers, and Keynote. It just says iWork.com, and I'm going to click on it. And I've set up my account in iWork.com. I'm going to send a note to someone that I'm sharing this with. So all I have to do is type in their email. It sees my address book, so it knows when I started to type in Tia, who that is. I'm going to type in a subject. Please check this out. Thanks for reviewing it. So I'm going to send this to Tia. I'm going to click share. And now what Pages is doing is creating the different formatted versions of this document and sending them up to iWork.com all automatically, and it's done. Okay, I've done it. It sent off a notification to Tia, it's up there in iWork.com, and that's it. It's that simple. So what's it like on the viewing side? What does Tia see? Well, I'm gonna switch computers up here. And now I'm on another computer, and let me just log in. This is Tia's computer. Different desktop, you can tell that's Tia. And next time Tia's in her email, what Tia's gonna see is a new message from me. The message I just sent, please check this out, tells Tia that she's been invited to view this document, the Phoenix Mission Report on iWork.com. Tia simply clicks View Document, and that launches Tia's browser. And again, this is amazing. This can be a Mac or a PC running any of the popular browsers, Safari, I think the coolest browser, or Firefox, or IE, or whatever Tia uses. And this is what Tia sees. Tia sees the document. And you have to stop for a second and look at this, because it looks like Pages, but I'm actually on iWork.com. Tia can read the document, go through the different pages. Tia can decide to leave a note to me on a section, maybe select this point where it says the friction causes the spacecraft to heat up to about 2,600 degrees Fahrenheit, add a comment. What's this in Celsius? So Tia can leave notes back to me. And there can be multiple people viewing the document, and they can leave notes to each other about the entire document. So on the right-hand side, Tia can say, I've reviewed it. It looks great. And post that note for all of us to see. And most importantly, on the right-hand side is this download button. So Tia can now click that button, and if Tia wanted to edit it herself, she could open it up in Pages if she has Pages 09, or read it as a PDF file, or even as a Microsoft Word file. So you're now sharing documents with other people who don't have iWork, but they can all open and view the documents too. So it's a really great way to share these documents around. So that's what Tia gets to do. Let me go back to my computer. So here I am back on my Mac, and I want to see the different comments coming in and communicate with those people. Well, I'm in Pages, and under the Share menu, there's a new item there that says Show Shared Documents. I'm going to click on that. It's going to take me in my browser to iWork.com to see the same shared document. So now we're all looking online at that shared document. And right here is a list. I have more than one shared document, so I'm going to see all the documents I'm sharing. The top one is the newest one, the Phoenix Mission Report, and there's a blue dot next to it telling me there's a new note there that I need to read. So here I am. I'm online seeing the same document Tia's seeing. I see an orange tab on a page telling me there's a new note there, and there's Tia's note, and I can reply right in the note. I can write back in the document-wide notes. It's all right here for us to collaborate together. Let me go back to my shared documents list. So I have pages document, keynote documents, numbers documents, as many as I want. I can share here on iWork.com. So for example, let me click this keynote document. And there's a keynote presentation that I've shared online via iWork.com. Beautifully rendered, just the same way it is in my own version of Keynote. And I see all the notes from the different people. We have four other people viewing this online and sharing notes together. So that's what it's like using iWork.com, a great online service for sharing and collaborating on documents. Now, this is the beginning of a new service. It's something that we're going to find out together all the great things we can do. Customers can sign up free for the beta. In the end, it'll be a fee-based service, but for now, it's a free beta to collaborate with us. There's a place where customers can send in their comments and tell us how it's working and ideas they have for how it should do it, how it should work. And I think there's things that we haven't even discovered that would be really powerful. For example, this is a lot easier way for me to send you a document rather than trying to send big files through email. It's also a great way if I want to get to documents anywhere in the world. I can put some of my important documents there, and I can go up to any computer, go in the browser, and get access to those documents wherever I need them without even taking my computer with me. So a lot of really powerful ideas in this new iWork.com service. So again, it's a beta, and it launches today. And as a publisher, you get to it via the new iWork 09 applications that started shipping today. So that's the second thing, iWork, in addition to iLife, that I want to talk to you about today. One more thing, the third thing, and number three is the new 17-inch MacBook Pro. Yeah. Last year was a big year for notebooks at Apple. We introduced some incredible new products. We started the year with the MacBook Air, the thinnest notebook in the world, and to that, later we added the 13-inch MacBook and the 15-inch MacBook Pro. All of these based on this incredible new architecture called the Precision Unibody Enclosure. And that simply meant we came out with a better way to make a notebook that makes it sturdier, thinner, lighter, more beautiful. And it's worked incredibly well. People really love them. Our customers love them, and the reviews have been fantastic. Ed Bega, the USA Today, said, Apple's fashioned a winner with the new MacBook. David Pogue of the New York Times, Apple's MacBook is a thing of beauty. And Walt Mossberg of the Wall Street Journal, Apple's new MacBook is a terrific choice for consumers and students. And I'm really proud to tell you, for the last 8 months running, if you look at a list of all the notebook products sold in the United States, a MacBook has been number one on that list every month. Yeah. So these products are great. The new 13-inch MacBook and the 15-inch MacBook Pro. And I'm really proud to be the first to show you the new high-end of our line, the 17-inch MacBook Pro. It's absolutely stunning. It's super thin, 0.98 inches thin. That's the world's thinnest 17-inch notebook. At 6.6 pounds, it's also the world's lightest 17-inch notebook. And it's simply stunning. It's got a beautiful 17-inch LED backlit display that's high resolution, 1920 by 1200, and this is the best display we've ever shipped in a notebook. It's got a wide viewing angle, 140 by 120, high contrast ratio, and displays the most amount of colors we've ever displayed on a notebook display, 60% greater color gamut than the previous 17-inch notebook display. As you know, our notebook displays have this beautiful glossy finish on them, really helps get dark, dark blacks and great color contrast. But some of our highest-end customers would really rather not have a glossy panel on the front, so we've also created, for the first time with a 17-inch, an anti-glare option. See, I told you, there are a few of them out there. And really, the only way we could do this was to remove that glass in the front and then build a metal bezel around it to hold the display. So it has the same display properties for anti-glare as our last 17-inch notebook. But I'm going to show the glossy version because that's my favorite. On the right-hand side, you see the SuperDrive and Kensington lock. On the left-hand side, you see all the I.O. You've got all that great I.O., the MagSafe connector, gigabit Ethernet, FireWire 800, three USB 2 ports, the new mini display port, digital and analog audio in and out, an express card 34, and the integrated battery connector. So you can see your battery life just from the side without turning it over. So that's the view on the outside. Look at it from the top. You see something really important, the new glass trackpad. This has been a huge hit with our customers. The glass trackpad is now larger, 40% larger. It has multi-touch. The whole surface clicks, and it's glassy, smooth. And if you want multi-button support, you can program it for left and right mouse buttons. It supports all the latest new gestures we've come out with. It has been a big hit with customers. Inside, we've got a new generation of Intel Core 2 Duo processor that get us up to 2.93 gigahertz with a 6 meg L2 cache. Can have up to 8 gigs of memory, now running at a gigahertz of DDR3. And what's been really successful with these new MacBooks is the new NVIDIA graphics options. So we've built in both the integrated GeForce 9400M as well as the discrete 9600 GT with 512 megs of memory. So you have both built in. Hard drive standard with 320 gigabytes, and you can also upgrade a solid state drive if you'd like that up to 256 gigabytes. And it's got all the features that make MacBooks and MacBook Pros unique that no one else has. I won't go through the whole list, but they're all in there. This is the coolest notebook. And it works with the new mini display port with our brand new cinema display, our LED cinema display. It's absolutely beautiful together. So I've talked about all these new features, but I haven't talked about one that's the most innovative and greatest new feature, and that's the battery. So we challenged our engineering team to do something really important, to deliver our longest lasting battery life ever, but to do it keeping the notebook just as thin and just as light. So to explain what they've done and how they've done it, I'm going to run a video where the engineers can tell you themselves about this great new advance in battery technology.
At Apple, we're always looking for ways to advance the performance of our portable products. Battery technology and design was one of those areas that we saw the opportunity for some really key advancements. With the new 17-inch MacBook Pro, we've designed a battery that will last up to 8 hours on a single charge and can be fully recharged up to 1,000 times. And we've done it all without adding to the size, weight, or even the price of the notebook. In the process, we've built a more environmentally friendly computer.
The key to building a long-lasting battery is making it bigger. A bigger battery with more capacity means longer battery life. When we design a portable product, every tenth of a millimeter is precious. The challenge, designing a bigger battery, is where to find the space to put it. We found that when you design for a removable battery, there's a lot of wasted space. A lot of that space and volume is used for mechanisms, structure, battery compartment, even removable doors. By embedding the battery and removing all the infrastructure associated with a removable battery, we were able to create a notebook with a 40% larger battery that lasts up to 8 hours on a single charge at the same size and weight.
In the case of Apple, we have scientists, chemists, engineers that are dedicated to battery development. So we're able to build batteries that are custom designed for the computers that they're going to go into.
Battery life is really just a simple matter of how much energy you can store in the computer. When you open up a notebook computer from a lot of our competition, you'll see cylindrical cells that are like AA batteries that you can buy. There's a lot of empty space in there. That's space that you could use for storing energy. And so by creating custom-shaped cells that we have in our batteries, you can fill all of the space much more effectively than you can with cylindrical shapes. You can also customize it to be all kinds of different sizes, and that's what we do. To make our batteries extremely thin, we use lithium polymer technology. We start with these very large sheets of tissue-like foil. and you coat those with the active material that stores the energy for the battery. In our case, it's an advanced chemistry that extends the lifespan of the cells 3 times the industry standard. Then they're wound together into an electrode roll. And then this roll is compressed into the correct shape, just to our precise dimensions. We go very deep into the design of a battery and cell engineering. You won't find that anywhere else in the computer industry.
In addition to advanced chemistry, one of the breakthroughs of our battery design is the concept of adaptive charging. This actually reduces the wear and tear on the battery as we charge it. With these new technologies, we're able to achieve up to 1,000 recharges, and that's more than 3 times the recharges of a typical notebook battery.
How the industry charges is taking these lithium-ion cells, okay, putting them into a system, charging at a constant voltage until they're full, and then they stop. That can wear out a battery prematurely. What we did was we have a chip within the battery that talks to each one of the individual cells and reports back on its state to the system. And the system goes back and adjusts the current accordingly. The new 17-inch MacBook Pro will have greater than 3 times the number of recharges and greater than 3 times the battery lifespan compared to the industry standard.
We're always looking for ways to make our products greener. From an environmental perspective, the new 17-inch MacBook Pro is a real breakthrough. It's free of many of the harmful toxins found in other computers. It runs on less than 50% the energy of a single light bulb, and it's made of highly recyclable aluminum and glass.
But we also take it one step further. Because this battery can recharge up to 1,000 times, its lifespan is extended up to 5 years. That means a lot less batteries will end up in landfills.
At Apple, we constantly strive to create the thinnest and lightest 17-inch products we can design. And often this has led us to the very forefront of battery technology. We've thought about how do you accomplish this really far out goal of being able to get a useful day's worth of work done on a single battery charge? And how do you create a design where the battery can last for years and years? And we think we finally come up with a convergence of technologies that makes that dream that we've been pursuing for a long time really possible.
So that's the battery in the new 17-inch MacBook Pro. Bob and his team has done a remarkable job delivering a new advanced chemistry to these batteries, intelligently monitoring a number of vectors inside the notebook to manage it well, and then adaptively charging it to make it get a much more extended lifespan. And what does it mean for all of us using these great notebooks? Incredible battery life. If you're using the discrete graphics, you can get up to 7 hours. And if you're using the integrated graphics, you can get up to 8 hours now on a single charge when you're using our new 17-inch MacBook Pro. That's 3 hours longer than the previous 17-inch MacBook Pro, a 60% increase in battery life. That's simply remarkable. And they did it keeping it just as thin and just as light. And more importantly, they did it in a way that's incredibly environmentally friendly, because longer recharges, more of them, mean it lasts longer and fewer batteries are thrown away and disposed of in our environment. They're also PVC-free and BFR-free. And if you ever do need to exchange it, we've got a take-back and recycling program to make sure they're disposed of properly. So it's a really great story, and it's a breakthrough that we're really proud of. The new 17-inch MacBook Pro, as before, it comes in one configuration. You can build to order any options you want. The same price as previously, $2,799. And that gets you the 17-inch LED display, a 2.66 gigahertz Core 2 Duo processor, 4 gigs of a gigahertz memory, both the integrated and the discrete NVIDIA graphics, a 320 gigabyte hard drive, and a super drive. And the new 17-inch MacBook Pro starts shipping at the end of this month in late January. Now, as we've done on a number of our products going forward, we want to keep doing, we want to give you an environmental report card. We spent a great deal of time caring about this. And first of all, our new 17-inch MacBook Pro is EP Gold status, which is a really great standard and the highest level for our notebooks. We have arsenic-free glass, BFR-free, mercury-free, PVC-free system. It's highly recyclable with all the great high-quality glass and aluminum we use in our product. And really important, 34% smaller packaging. So when we ship millions of these around the world, we use less fossil fuels doing so. And this great new 1,000 recharge cycle battery. So that's the new 17-inch MacBook Pro. We're so proud of it, we couldn't help ourselves. We had to make a TV ad for it. So I'd like to show you that new ad.
This is the new 17-inch MacBook Pro. It has a revolutionary new battery that runs up to an astonishing 8 hours per charge and can be recharged up to 1,000 times. That's a typical 5-year lifespan, which is nearly 3 times longer than batteries in most notebooks and means fewer batteries in landfills. Just another reason the new MacBooks are the world's greenest family of notebooks.
So the new 17-inch MacBook Pro joins the 13-inch MacBook and the 15-inch MacBook Pro, completes our lineup of the world's greenest and the best family of notebooks available. So we do have one last thing in this Macworld keynote, and we have some news, some things we're doing with iTunes. So I know I told you, I'd tell you it's all about the Mac, but there's one last thing, there's some pretty powerful things that are amazing happening with iTunes, and I think it's important to share them. iTunes is the world's best music player and has the most amazing music store. We started the iTunes Music Store 6 years ago in 2003, April of 2003. In just less than 6 years, what's happened has been astounding. We've now sold over 6 billion songs. That's amazing. And iTunes is the world's largest media library, music library, with over 10 million songs. 10 million songs. And we now have over 75 million accounts with credit cards. Now, if you remember back in 2003, we started iTunes saying we wanted to give customers a legal way to purchase music digitally over the internet. And it's so great to see how many people agreed with us and want to take part in this legal way to purchase music. And with all this, iTunes became the number one channel for music in the United States. So what's new with iTunes in 2009? I'd like to tell you about 3 things today that are happening. First, price. As you know, we've worked with all the major music companies, as well as thousands of independents. And over the last 6 years, we've had one pricing model for all songs, 99 cents. And the music companies have told us they want more flexibility. So starting in April, we're going to give them more flexibility because we're going to create 3 pricing tiers. They'll still be 99 cents. There'll also be a pricing tier at 69 cents and at $1.29. And based on how they choose to offer us their music, we'll sell them at $69, $99, and $129. And I can tell you, we know already that more songs are going to be sold or offered at $69 than $129. So there's going to be a benefit to a lot of customers. So that's the first thing, what we're doing with price, and that comes in April. The second thing we're doing, iTunes Plus. If you follow what we've done with iTunes Plus, you probably already know what iTunes Plus is. But for those who don't, iTunes Plus is a way that we offer music that is completely DRM-free. You can put it on as many computers that you own. It's also encoded at a much higher quality bit rate, 256 KB encoding of AEC, so it's near indistinguishable from the original recording. And for customers that have already purchased music, iTunes Plus offers a really easy way to upgrade your whole library to iTunes Plus. Well, what's new today is that we've worked with all the major music companies, and starting today, we're going to offer 8 million of the songs all DRM-free. 8 million. And by the end of this quarter, we'll finish out the 2 million more, and all 10 million songs of iTunes will now be DRM-free. just in case someone didn't understand, I had to make one more slide on it. All songs will be DRM-free in iTunes via iTunes Plus. Now, as I said, it's really easy to go in and upgrade your entire library to iTunes Plus and upgrade all your music to now being DRM-free. So that's iTunes Plus. That's the second thing. The third new thing happening with iTunes has to do with the iPhone. As you know, on the iPhone, we have the iTunes Wi-Fi Music Store. And it's the most popular wireless music store for buying music on devices like cell phones. And you can go in and you can see what's hot. You can check the top albums and songs. You can find an album you want to buy the album, buy the song. And now, with the iTunes Music Store, it's no longer the iTunes Wi-Fi Music Store. It's just the iTunes Music Store because it supports downloading and buying your music on both Wi-Fi and 3G cellular networks. So that means you get access to all these songs to the same price. A lot of others don't do that. They're the same price that we've talked about. It's the same selection, all of that incredible over 10 million songs available to you right on your iPhone. It's the same quality, up to 256 KB encoding of AAC you get right over the air on your iPhone. This means that you can, on your iPhone, preview and purchase music now, anytime, anywhere, whether on Wi-Fi or 3G networks. And whenever you sync your iPhone back to your computer, we sync back the music. It's the same music on your iTunes on your computer and iTunes on your phone. This is a really big step for wireless music on cell phones, and that starts today. Today, you can start using iTunes over your 3G network. This is really profound, that now iTunes, on your phone, DRM-free, 256 KB songs over wireless networks, the same price, and they sync back and work on your computer right into iTunes. Simple idea, a really big step for digital music, and I think a really leading step for Apple. And now we're ending on music, and in many of our Macworld keynotes, we've tried to make sure we always come back to remembering why we do this. Why we create products like the iPod and iTunes and GarageBand, all these great products around music, simply because we love great music. That's really the heart of it, how it all started and what still matters. So I think it's fitting that we end our last Macworld keynote with an artist that really has some amazing music and has been recognized as a true legend in our industry. Look at these awards. Unbelievable. 15 Grammy Awards, 2 Emmy Awards, a Jazz Master Award, a Kennedy Center honoree, a UN Humanitarian of the Year, over 100 albums, over 50 million records sold worldwide, and a song I think that's going to be really appropriate for this last Macworld. So with no more fanfare, it's my honor to introduce to you Mr. Tony Bennett.
Tree of life, I just picked me a plum. You came along and everything started to hum. Still, it's a real good bet. The best is yet to come. The best is yet to come, and babe, won't that be fine? You think you've seen the sun, but you ain't seen it shine. Wait till the warm-up's underway. Wait till our lips have met. Wait till you see that sunshine day. You ain't seen nothing yet. The best is yet to come, and babe, won't that be fine? The best is yet to come, come the day you're mine. Come the day you're mine. I'm gonna teach you to fly. We've only tasted the wine. We're gonna drain the cup dry. Wait till your charms are ripe for these arms to surround. You think you've flown before, but the ground. Wait till you're locked in my embrace. Wait till I draw you near. Wait till you see that sunshine place. Ain't nothing like it here. The best is yet to come, and babe, won't it be fine? The best is yet to come. Come the day you're mine. Out of the tree of life, I just picked me a plum. Good morning. Thank you. Amazing. Thank you very much. The loveliness of Paris seems somehow sadly gay. The glory that was Rome is of another day. Well, I was terribly alone and forgotten in Manhattan. I'm going home to my city by the bay. I left my heart. In San Francisco. High on a hill. It calls to me. To be where little cable cars climb halfway to the stars. The morning fog may chill the air. I don't care, my love waits there. In San Francisco, above the blue, when I come home to you, San Francisco, your golden sun will shine for me.
Thank you very much, everyone. That's our show for Macworld 2009. I want to thank you again. You've been a wonderful audience. I appreciate you giving us your time and being here. And as you know, putting on a show like this can't be done without the help of a lot of people. So I want to thank everyone from my family to all my friends at Apple. It's an incredible group of people that make the world's best products and help us try to explain a little bit of the love we put into these products to you. And so please enjoy the rest of the show. Go down in the booth and try out iLife and iWork and check out the new 17-inch MacBook Pro and enjoy the rest of the week. Thank you very much.